So we're going to be picking up in Leviticus chapter 19. Now, if you're just joining us tonight for the first time in a while, this is a blessing and a curse. A blessing because the last couple of chapters have been really neat. Dealing with bodily functions and sexual immorality and stuff. So you've joined in a good night and kind of an interesting night at the same time, because we're picking up where we left off last week, continuing in the instruction to the children of Israel in regards to conduct, in regards to how God wants his kids to live and what it's to look like. So it's still good. It's still something that hopefully when I say that, you think, I'd like to know that. I want to be doing that. You know, I get that kind of mindset that says, yeah, I'd like to understand the way God wants me to live, because I really do want to live like he wants. And we've seen over and over throughout the studies of the past that what we find is that it offers us an immense benefit and immense protection in our lives, and it's just good stuff. So, instead of looking at this law that we're going to go through tonight, to us, we're going to kind of look at it in regards to Christian living, and some things are going to apply to us, and some things aren't going to apply so much because of cultural differences, and we can definitely say that. I mean, There's times when I think the church takes it too far to try to be relevant with the culture and stuff, but here there's going to definitely be cultural differences as we're looking back thousands and thousands of years, not just 2,000 years ago, which 2,000 years ago is a pretty long time. So Jesus didn't have the problem of his iPad batteries dying, so... Anyways, so we're going to have instruction on how to live this evening, and we're going to have instruction on how not to live this evening. And what both of those things are going to look like as we're hearing the word, and as we're living among the world, we want to live in a place and in a way that's different, and that's what this whole book has been about of Leviticus, and we're going to be right here shortly reading verse 2, which is the theme verse of Leviticus, and we might, at the end of our study, maybe get to the theme verse again in chapter 20 towards the end, if we make it that far. There's no guarantees with me, but I'm going to try to make it that far. So the theme is to be holy, is to be separate, is to be consecrated, is to be set apart. So chapter 19, verse 1 says this, "And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to all the congregation of the children of Israel and say to them, you shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy. You shall be holy, for I am holy." And the reason I have this picture up here is because I thought it was a good reminder of where we're still at. We have the tabernacle. Moses is still talking to God. This is a long conversation, to put it, you know, shortly. But he says in verse 2, look back there with me at the end of verse 2, "We shall be holy because he is holy. He, the Lord our God, is holy." So here's the why. You and I are ambassadors for Christ. And I've said that before. Hopefully you've heard that before. An ambassador is a representative. We're representatives of God to this world. And that's just part of our, part of what we get to do, I should say, as a light unto the world, as hope to the hopeless. And we should be that. We should have that difference in us. So God says in this, don't look like them, look like me. Don't look like the world, look like me. So what is your representation of Jesus look like to those around you? If people look at your life, would they think Jesus used foul language? Would they think Jesus smoked cigarettes? And the only reason I say that is because I had someone say that to me once, and they were using a verse out of context. They said, in order to become all things to all people, it's in 1 Corinthians, in order to reach them with the gospel, this person told me, I took up smoking and foul language, and I listened to the bad music that they do. And I said, really? Well, that's interesting. And really, what I said to him was a little more serious than really that's interesting. I said, look, you may be the only Jesus that they ever see. And if you don't look any different, if you don't have a different flavor, what good is it? We're to be flavorful. We're to have a different flavor. You know, the word says that we're to be flavored with salt. And if the salt loses its flavor, what good? What it's like putting nothing on your food. What are you putting on there? Nothing. There's no flavor in this. Why are you doing it? I don't know. I always used to do it. So here's a few questions that I had for myself as I'm looking at this. Question number one. Does my temper look more like the world's temper? Or what maybe we see modeled in the world or on TV or whatever, or even my parents, or does it look more like Jesus? Does my language look like the world's language? Does it look like Jesus? The jokes that I tell or that I hear. And really when I thought of this, I thought, you know, it goes back to the book of Acts. It goes back to the term Christian for us New Testament believers. In the book of Acts, the first time they called the church, the gatherer, the followers of Christ, Christians, it was a derogatory statement. And it really meant little Jesuses. You little Jesus! You know, that's kind of what it was like. Which you're like, oh, wow, that really hurt. Well, we shouldn't say that. That's the best you got. Maybe in my case, they would say, you big Jesus, or whatever. But anyways, I thought about when people look at my life, would they say that? Would they even know that? Would they call me a little Christian? And do I look like Jesus part of the time, all the time, most of the time? But if somebody calls us that, really, what a compliment. So back to the context that God says in verse 2. He says, you shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy. And then he kind of moves on, and he starts addressing what this is going to look like. Some of the things in our life, guidelines, rules for us to look at in our life that's going to make us look different than the world around us. And of course, this is specifically to the children of Israel in their day and age, and it's going to be dealing with the people, the pagans that were around them. So, the first two things we look at in verse 3. It says, every one of you shall revere his mother and his father, and keep my Sabbaths. I am the Lord your God. The first thing he says is there needs to be honor in the family. It's in the family. You need to honor your father and mother. And the second thing is the observation of the days that are set apart to honor the Lord. And I like this because in my mind I go, whoa, it's the family unit and church. He starts off saying, your family should look different than the world, and you should be in church, in fellowship with the other believers. Of course, that's in our context, in our day and age, in the New Testament. And to me, when I look at these two places should be the most impactful and biggest differences from the world in our lives. And they kind of intertwine together, the family and the church. The home is to be a place where God and his word are honored, are listened to. And the family is to be a place where the love and the good works are practiced and learned and taught sometimes tediously and tirelessly, right? So, question. Is my home and my family perfect? Yes. No. Right? Hopefully you went, what? Are you kidding me? We are all made of flesh in my family, every single one of us. We all have this tent. But it should be a safe place for our kids and for even ourselves to learn and grow and fall down and have one another's back. A place of safety that we can say, it's okay if you fell, but let's get back up and let's go back to Jesus. And let's learn how to do that, because one day when we get out on our own, we're going to fall and we're going to have to get back up, and we need to know we can turn back to Jesus. But here's the newsflash. There is no perfect home. I thought about that, and I thought, even in the home that Jesus grew up in, it was not perfect. There was only one perfect thing there. And it probably drove his parents up the wall. I know it would drive me up the wall. I said, you always get it right. What's the matter with you, Jesus? But really, what does God say about the family with the commandment? It's the commandment is for the children to honor the mother and the father. And when I look around at our culture, I think, oh, how we need that. Oh, how our kids need to live in a place where they put these things down and have a conversation with a human being and learn to live this way and not how many likes I got today. Yay. You know, it's crazy some of the statistics on what Facebook is doing to children's lives, because it all revolves around how many people like them, and the results, the statistics say that the more the kids are on Facebook, the more depressed they are. Really, the more depressed they are, but the more they also show, hey, look at me, huh, selfies, ching ching, I'm all good, but they're really struggling and suffering inside as a result of really a lack of genuine, healthy relationships. Anyways, that's my own soapbox. I get excited about those things. But I think about honoring parents, honoring the family. I think about that going out the window. I think about sitcoms beginning to get worse and worse, continuing. Now it's just craziness. But it seems to me like this is being lost in our society. So I have a question. Is there any teachers in here? Anybody teach in maybe the public schools in here? No, nobody's in here. And the reason I ask is because if it's lost in the schoolroom, respect for teachers, it's a direct result. It's because it's lost at home. It's not because teachers are doing a poor job. It's not because what are they feeding these kids? It's failed parenting. It's failed structure and the structure that we have from God. Super important for me. I say for us, but for me, I've got kids, I've got young ones in the house. It's super important for me to train them to respect their mother. Every once in a while I catch myself saying, hey, that's my wife you're talking about, and we've been married way longer than you've been around. They're like, oh, you need to talk to her with respect. And then of course, first family, second, the church, a place where we gather with like-minded people who love God and stir up love and good works among each other, a place where we hear sound doctrine and the Lord moves in spirit and power and in truth in our lives. It's essential. It's a place that we need to be. If we're going to look different, it's going to be because we follow God's word in our homes and our families, and we gather together with the church. And, of course, we have the Holy Spirit living inside of us, the power that changes our lives. We need these things. We need these things. And, you know, I look around. Sometimes it's easy to get that mindset, you know, like it's too late for our nation. But God can do a mighty thing. God's a little bigger than our nation. I mean, sometimes I think we forget, you know, we think, well, that's a lot of mess to clean up. Well, God's pretty big, just saying. Verse 4, the next thing he says, instruction to the children of Israel, do not turn to idols, nor make for yourselves molded gods. I am the Lord your God. The word idol, I don't know if you know this, but the word idol literally means little nothings. Worshiping little nothings sounds a little nonsensical, right? By definition, an idol is anything that is created that you would worship. So, again, which by definition, anything that's created is anything other than the uncreated one. Anything other than God. Because everything in creation is created, right? He made it. So, I mean, of course, it includes the cultures that would worship the sun or the moon or whatever, any of those kind of things, because that's all part of creation. But here he's talking more about molded, carved images. And it wasn't just the little carvings or the little molded guys, but really what it was the ideas behind the images. And by the ideas behind the images, I mean the ideas behind worshiping those images, what it took to worship those gods. And they were very worldly, they were very ungodly, and we know from a couple studies back, they were demonic. And it took to worship, I mean, the ideas behind the little gods where you worship this god to get riches, and you worship this god to have success, and you worship this god for the god of sex, and you worship this idol for the idol of pleasure, and you all these things, you worship this one for the idol of self. And so it's all of these ideas of worship, and they were worshipped in very horrible ways. So it's not just that God's like in a battle with some little nothings. He's really in a battle for our heart, for what we're going to hold in high esteem, ourselves, our pleasure, or him, his word, who he is, which he is righteousness, he is truth, he is justice, he is love. And man, we need that in our lives, amen? Verse 5, he says, "And if you offer a sacrifice of a peace offering to the Lord, you shall offer it of your own free will. It shall be eaten the same day you offer it, and on the next day, if any remains until the third day, it shall be burned in the fire. And if it is eaten at all on the third day, it is an abomination. It shall not be accepted. Therefore, everyone who eats it shall bear his iniquity, because he has profaned the hallowed offering of the Lord. And that person shall be cut off from his people." So he kind of turns from pagan things that are going on, and he turns back to something that he instituted, which was this offering, this peace offering. And so he gives this direction for a few different reasons. One of them, first and foremost, I think probably was for their own health. They don't have refrigerators, right? And they're like, he says, don't let that meat sit on the counter for 3 days and then eat it. Ew, you know, that kind of thing. But this offering was the barbecue offering. It was the sacrifice offering. There's one commentary that I listened to, and he says, barbecue. I don't know if you probably know who that is. If you've heard him before, you're going, oh yeah, I know exactly who that is. But anyways, I get, every time I say barbecue, that goes off in my head. Barbecue. And I'm like, okay, where's the sauce? Anyways, sorry, rabbit trails happen in my brain frequently. But this is the party. It's the barbecue sacrifice. Everyone gets to partake of it. The priest, the family, and you even get to take it home to your family and share it with the kids. And so God didn't want them to try to keep it any longer. And there's, I think, some more reasons than just that. The second one is that this offering, the second reason that the Lord gave this direction, this offering is not an offering of necessity like the sin offering. It wasn't one you had to do. It wasn't one you blew it. It's you got to go now. You got to get right with the Lord. It's really an act of worship and communion with God. So some of the commentary said, hey, this is a reminder from God to say, I know you're doing the other ones, but don't forsake just worshiping me. And that speaks to my heart. I know you come to me when you messed up and you want to get right. I know you come to me when you have problems or issues or things looming on the horizon, when things aren't going very good. But don't forget to come to me just to worship. Don't forget to come just to thank me for what I've done. And it's not that he needs us to bow to him. It's because it does something for us to just sit alone and worship God. And that leads me kind of to the third reminder that this text gives us, not to eat it on the third day, which spiritually speaking has the ideas that there are no spiritual leftovers. And what I mean by that is you can't go to church on Sunday and expect to be good for the month. I got my church in for the month. Cha-ching, I'm out of here. It doesn't work like that. And even more so, I would say, with our devotional life. Your devotions from yesterday, your intimate time with you and Jesus and just his word and gleaning and listening to him from yesterday isn't good enough to keep you going till tomorrow. We need to spend time with him day in and day out and have almost that attitude of, I don't want to miss a word. God, I don't want to miss a word that you have for me. And you know you have, if your mercies are new every morning, you know you want to speak to me every day. You know you want to, we know he wants to share with us and move in our lives and speak to us. We need to have fresh spiritual food. One of my favorite pictures of this is the manna in the wilderness. You guys remember the story? We went through it a while back. They were to get it every win. Every morning, it would come with the dew, and they would get it, and they'd make cakes. And it's one of my favorite stories because it's the origins of donuts. They would make little cakes, and they'd fry them, and they tasted like honey. And I'm like, that's a donut, right? Yes! I'm sorry. Flesh is getting involved here. It was kind of like a chocolate-filled croissant. No, I'm just kidding. I just said that because U-Turn had a bunch of those. But anyways... every morning, but what happened was the guys, they went out with like their baskets, even though God told them not to, they filled them up and they're going to keep it for like the next day. And what happened? They got up in the morning and it was full of worms and it was gross. And you almost get the picture that they wanted to fill this basket and now I don't have to get up in the morning and collect, I'm going to sleep in. They got up and went, And it just paints a picture in my heart. Don't sleep, don't forsake the fresh time with the Lord for a few more snooze buttons. Maybe you guys don't use the snooze. I use the snooze, and my wife wants to kill me, I know. But anyways. Now, we shift gears again, and God puts his plan, his welfare plan for the poor in this time, in this culture, in this nation. Verse 9, he says, when you reap the harvest of your land, you shall not wholly reap the corners of your field, nor shall you gather the gleanings of your harvest. And you shall not glean your vineyard, nor shall you gather every grape of your vineyard. You shall leave them for the poor and the stranger. I am the Lord your God. So he gives them this direction, this instruction to the landowner or crop owners to make provision for the poor. So God says, hey, if you've got grain, if you're into grain and you've got a property where you're growing wheat in the field, you leave the corners and you don't pick all of it. Or if you're a vineyard owner, you don't gather every grape at harvest time. You leave some. You leave some behind for the people that don't have anything, the people that are without, the people that are in need. So God, he takes this step in here in his word to look after the poor, the widow, the orphan, and the stranger, and he chooses to do it in this way. And I do want you to notice what God doesn't say to these landowners, to these farm or crop owners. He doesn't say, I want you to go and pick the field, and I want you to get a few bags worth of 10 or 5% or whatever of your food, and I want you to take it to the doors of the poor people. He doesn't say, give them handouts. He says, they got to get up, they got to come to your field, and they got to sweat. They got to pick some grain. They got to work for what they get. Personally, I like God's way. I think that's a good thing right there. That's a good thing. I just saw an interview today on Facebook with this lady, and she was telling the interviewer, I guess, how she got like $800 in food stamps, $400 in something else, and then $300 in WIC every month. And they said, well, will you get a job? And she's like, I just don't want to get a job. Why would I get a job? I'm like, yeah, I understand that. But in God's way, it's like you don't get up, you don't pick it, you don't eat. And I like it. I like it. So God left this provision. And you know, this is the provision that how through Naomi, Ruth met Boaz. If you read that story, it's the book of Ruth. But Ruth met Boaz by gleaning through his field. And if you remember that story from Ruth and Boaz, who eventually got married, comes David through that seed, and through the seed of David comes Jesus, our Messiah. So God is interesting how woven through the story. God uses this to bless somebody who's willing to go to the field and pick, and God blesses them for it. I love it. But I also want you to know something. You never have to be worried. Those landowners never had to be worried if they were going to have enough, because if they honored God in their life, you better believe that God's blessing was on their fields. And God's blessing was on their crops. And it's the same for us today. Man, if you honor God in your finances, don't worry. Now, of course, things are going to happen, and what are you going to do? You're going to bite your nails off. And that happens sometimes. But then what happens is God's going to come through, and you're going to go, oh yeah, God, I forgot. You take care of me. You take care of me. And part of that is in Malachi, in the tithing principle. I love that section. We're not going to look at it tonight. Maybe jot that down and look at it for yourself. But there is a huge blessing that God will rebuke the devourer. One of his descriptions are, like, to me it reminds me of a really good financial commercial. Feel like you got holes in your pockets? Not getting anywhere? The devil ripping you off? Turn to the Lord. Seriously though, you do things God's way, you do finances God's way, and he'll take care of you. I'm living proof. Now, I'm not the best with the books, but I'm living proof that God will take care of you. And I'm just, you're good. That's all I can say. You're good. Even when I'm faithless, he remains faithful. Amen. Okay, so to me, these next verses, 11 and 18, they're verses that are really pertaining a lot to just normal human conduct. Not dealing with sacrificing your kids to an idol, not dealing with incest, none of those things. Really, really just normal life stuff. And that we're to give our lives to God here, even in the common things. So verse 11, he says, you shall not steal, nor deal falsely, nor lie to one another. This is already in the Ten Commandments, already been covered in Exodus, but there's just a reminder. And you would think that God wouldn't have to remind his kids of this, but then I think of how often I have to remind my kids of these very things. Hey, you're not supposed to lie. The last one was, everybody else does it. I'm like, oh! And you just want to bite your tongue, and then your wife goes, Revelation 21, liars go to hell. And I'm like, yes, get her! I'm just kidding. It wasn't quite like that, but I had to sit down and talk to her and say, man, we went through the whole thing. Lying breaks trust. What does that mean? It means when you get older and you want to go hang out with so-and-so at so-and-so's house, I say no because I can't trust you because you lie to me. It's a life lesson, right? And they're just like, oh, that's why I can't lie? Well, no, we don't lie because it's bad. It's hurtful. But there are consequences to sin, and God shows us. But anyways, okay. Verse 12, he says, you shall not swear by my name falsely, nor shall you profane the name of your God. I am the Lord. So the word profane has the idea of making something common. That's really what it means. You shall not profane the name of God. You shall not make God's name common. You shall not bring it down. When I thought about this, I thought we're supposed to be living in a way that takes God's name and lifts it up. It says his ways are above the worldly ways. And he's worthy of honor, and he's worthy of us lifting up his name. But profaning would be just to take it down and make it common, make it of no big deal. Bring it down. One simple way to make God's name common is by not keeping your word. And according to verse 12, to swear to do something by the name of God and then not to do it, not to follow through. And you know, there's this idea that even makes it a little bit more, to me, it attaches it even more, and it's the idea that if you claim to be a Christian, guess what? Christ's name is attached to the title of who you are. So when you don't follow through on your word, or when you mess up and you shame him, You're doing that. You're bringing his name, you're profaning his name. So, really, we're not supposed to swear by the name of God anyways. And in Matthew chapter 5, you can just write that down or something in your margin if you want. Matthew 5, 33 through 37. Jesus says this whole thing, he says this whole section how we're not supposed to do that at all. I'm just going to read it quickly. It says, again, you have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not swear falsely, but shall perform your oaths to the Lord. But I say to you, do not swear at all. Neither by heaven, for it is God's throne, neither by the earth, for it is God's footstool, nor by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king, nor shall you swear by your head, because you cannot make one hair on your head white or black. But let your yes be yes, and let your no be no. Whatever is more than these is from the evil one. So, there it is. Not to swear, but let our yes be yes and our no be no, and know that what we do in our conduct is representing God. Verse 13, you shall not cheat your neighbor nor rob him. The wages of him who is hired shall not remain with you all night until morning. So, of course, you shouldn't cheat your neighbor, you shouldn't rob your neighbor. These are kind of everyday things. But in that wage thing, in that day, a day laborer usually got paid their wages at the end of the day. So if you're someone who has laborers, what this verse is saying is pay them when you said you would. Give them the check on time. Especially, in this case, he's saying, especially if you have the money, but you just are like, well, let me wait till I got more and it's more convenient for me. The word says, no, pay him when you have it. Verse 14, you shall not curse the deaf, nor put a stumbling block before the blind, but you shall fear your God, I am the Lord. So, of course, God is treating the people that have disability or the less fortunate kind. He says, don't mess with those people. I'm the Lord. I don't want you to do this. I don't want you to take advantage of somebody that's weak or you know, can't fend for themselves in any way. And you kind of think that doesn't need to be said, but of course, it does, probably more in other places than here, but still, we're going to say it. It's the word of God. But that, one of the commentaries I went through had the story of this, that he said, this guy was saying, you know, when my grandma got really old, she kept telling us the same stories over and over again. I don't know, you might relate to that. But he said one of the stories that she would tell was the story of when she was a little girl and she would take her great uncle to church on Sunday mornings. Actually, a group of the family, some brothers and sisters and a cousin or so, would take their great uncle. Now, the great uncle was blind and deaf, and so they would take him, she said, most of the time, we'd take him to the edge of this field and we'd sit him on a little short rock wall, and then we'd go play in the field, and he didn't know if he was in church or not. Then we'd take him back home. I thought, man, that's pretty. So I'm sure he probably did know that he wasn't, as the breeze was coming through, and he thought, man, they must have the door open at church today. But these kids, these little stinkers, these little connivers, they have flesh, and it's true, and we know it. Verse 15, you shall do no injustice in judgment. You shall not be partial to the poor, nor honor the person of the mighty. In righteousness you shall judge your neighbor. So he says, don't exalt the rich and put down the poor, and don't exalt the poor and put down the rich. And in, I don't know, I feel like sometimes in politics there's these two angles. Oh, the rich people, always doing everything, never giving anything to the poor. And the other side going, oh, they give everything to the poor and us poor rich. I don't know. I'm not going to touch that too much, but it's true. And really what he's saying is don't let money or the lack of money be your judgment of a person. Make sure you hold all of them in the same esteem, but rather the righteousness of a person. Judge them by their own righteousness, not their wealth. And it's easy to do. It's easy to have somebody with wealth come in or somebody that you think is somebody and treat them different than somebody else. But God says not to do it, whether in life, whether in the courtroom, whatever. Verse 16, he says, you shall not go about as a talebearer among your people, nor shall you take a stand against the life of your neighbor. I am the Lord. So no talebearing. What's a talebearer? It's someone who bears a tale, who carries a story. Really, he's talking about gossip. Don't gossip. Don't backbite. Don't talk about folks, right? Don't talk about each other. God doesn't like it. We shouldn't do it. And you know, it's an easy thing to do. You know, we set ourselves up for it sometimes. But it's one of those things that we shouldn't. And you know, I had this thought when I was pondering what this was about. Really, when we're talking about someone else, when we're talking about someone maybe where they failed or letting people in on some juice in their life or whatever, we're talking about someone who's created in the image of who? We're talking about somebody created in the image of God. No matter how distorted their image has become, God loves them. And he died for them. He died for whosoever. For God so loved the world. Not just us Christians. Sometimes we think like that. For God so loved everyone that he gave his son. 17. He says, you shall not hate your brother in your heart. You shall surely rebuke your neighbor and not bear sin because of him. You shall not hate your brother in your heart. We are not to hate someone in our heart. So maybe we should take a minute and just reflect and say, is there anyone in my life, in my heart, that I hate, that I completely dislike, maybe that I wished evil upon? Jesus even took it a step back. Not hate, he said, but is there someone who's offended you? Are you offended by someone? But I think for us, especially among the children of God, if there is anyone, according to this passage, the end there, the last little section, you're bearing sin because of him. It's not the other way around, which is the way I think we usually take it. We think that if someone's offended us, then they're in sin and they have the problem. According to this scripture, we're in sin if someone has offended us and we're not dealing with it the right way, the godly way. And what's the answer? It's found in Matthew chapter 18. I'm not going to turn there tonight, but if you want that answer, get in there and read it. I'll give you the short version. You're to go to that person, and you're to talk to him about it. We're to follow Matthew 18. And if that doesn't work, at least, I could say, at least we've done what God says in his word. And now at that point, we have to continue to give it to him. We give it to God. We bring it to the altar. We lay our own flesh down on that altar that we might give it to the Lord daily. And you know, you might have to do that daily for a while. And you might even have that question, so, well, if it keeps going on, how long do I have to keep giving it to the Lord? I think the answer is, as long as it takes. Keep coming to the Lord. Keep asking for forgiveness. And to me, I've been kind of going through one of these recently. And what I found was the more I prayed for this person, the more the Lord showed me how much he loved them. And it changed my heart. It moved my heart in a place that was good instead of evil, instead of frustrated. Verse 18, you shall not take vengeance. This kind of goes right along with it. You shall not take vengeance nor bear any grudge against the children of your people. But you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. If someone has offended us, and they will, we're not to take our own vengeance. And then he takes it one step further, and you're not even to hold a grudge. And then he takes it one step further from that and says, but you're to love this person as you love yourself. Whoa. Whoa. Love our neighbor as ourselves. You know, one of the things that when I read that in the Old Testament, in Leviticus, I think, whoa, this isn't the Old Testament? I thought the Old Testament God was trying to like zap everybody, right? He's like, no, I want to kill you. That's what I want to do. I want to kill you people. Oh, sometimes I look in the mirror and think, why don't you think that more often, Lord? But he doesn't. He loves us. He loves us. So from the Old Testament, this God, so don't let anyone tell you, you know, the God of the Old Testament's mean and cruel. You say, well, he tells me to love you. Verse 19. He says, you shall keep my statutes, and you shall not let your livestock breed with another kind, nor shall you sow your field with mixed seed, nor shall a garment of mixed linen and wool come upon you. Everybody check your tags. Obviously, this one doesn't really relate to us very much today. But I do like this section simply because it's showing that not everything that God is going to call you to do in this life deals with a direct sin. It could be something that's not that big of a thing, but God's saying, but I want you to do it. You know, sometimes we resist that and go, what? Well, they're not doing it. God's like, you're not them. I want you to follow me in this way. Man, would we be a people? Can we? I long to be a person that says, God, if you say to do something, I don't care what it is, I'll do it. And this is one of those sections. And of course, in my mind, I say, oh, of course I would do that. But I need to still check my heart. Because my heart always thinks more highly of itself than it is, right? Well, yes, I would do anything for you, Lord. I mean, they sound like Peter, right? The next thing I'm going, I don't know him, I swear, you know, a little girl, I don't know who he is. Verse 20, whoever lies carnally with a woman who is betrothed to a man as a concubine and who has not at all been redeemed nor given her freedom, for this there shall be scourging, but they shall not be put to death because she was not free, and he shall bring his trespass offering to the Lord. To the door of the tabernacle of meeting, a ram as a trespass offering. The priest shall make atonement for him with the ram of the trespass offering before the Lord for his son, which he has committed. For his sin which he has committed, and the sin which he has committed shall be forgiven him. To me, this is one of those ones you're like, what? What are you talking about? It seems to be that if a concubine, which is really a female slave, who is betrothed to someone, and I would say presumably her master, that's usually how that worked, and has sex with someone outside of that betrothal, that the penalty isn't death, but that they will be beaten. Now, some of the commentaries said that just the slave was beaten. Some of them said, I don't know, it doesn't say that to me. It says they're both beaten. But the free man will have to make atonement for his sin. And for some reason, that just doesn't click really good with me, right? I'm just kind of like, I'm clunking through that, going, I don't understand. Part of me wants to judge that and go, well, anyone else gets worse than that? I don't understand. But when I was thinking about this, the Lord just spoke to my heart and said, you can't judge that because you deserve death for your sin. And what did I do? I sent my son to die in your place for your sins. So what is it if I spare a slave and if I spare this man? I'm going, you're right. Good call. I love you, Lord. Thank you for saving me. We're moving on to verse 23. And when you come into the land and have planted all kinds of trees for food, then you shall count their fruit as uncircumcised. 3 years it shall be as uncircumcised to you. It shall not be eaten. But in the fourth year, its fruit shall be holy, a praise to the Lord. And in the fifth year, you may eat its fruit, that it may yield to you its increase. For I am the Lord your God. Again, okay. I don't really understand. So God says of these trees, the ones that are there already, you don't eat of them for 3 years. You let it just fall to the earth. Then the first good year, the fourth year, you get all of that fruit and you give it to God. You give it to him as praise. You offer it to him. And then on the fifth year, you can eat. So this is another one of those ones. It's not really dealing with sin, but it's dealing with something that maybe the pagans did. And God's saying, I don't want you to mix with what they're doing. I want you to do this separate. I want you to do it different from what the people and the world around you are doing. And so here it is. To me, it checks with my heart. It says, are you going to do it? Are you going to follow it? One commentary said this, though, about fruit and about trees. If God is this cautious with fruit from trees, then maybe we ought to be this cautious and patient with the fruit from people. And just keep pouring into them and waiting for the Lord to move and work in their lives. And if you say, man, I could pour into this person for a year, say, well, give it two, then give another year to the Lord. And then go back and see. I mean, and sometimes things in our lives, we need just time to keep going and to keep trying, maybe making mistakes and getting back up. But that we wouldn't just cut them off. We wouldn't just say, that tree's dead in my mind. But we would, it reminds me of the parable of the guy that went and he said, well, before you kill that tree, let me dig around it. Let me fertilize it. Let me do everything I can. And sometimes we're quick to just say, write people off and say, whatever. Instead of continuing to wait, continuing to look, continuing to be observant and pour in. Verse 26, it says, you shall not eat anything with the blood, nor shall you practice divination or soothsaying. So we kind of looked at eating, a few studies back, eating the blood. That was a no-no. You're not supposed to drink the blood. You're not supposed to eat the blood. The pagans do that. We saw God said, blood is important to me because the life is in the blood. And it's to be offered to me. It's not to be drank. It's not to be eaten. So then he looks on. We look on to these other two things in this verse. Divination. I looked up divination. Divination is trying to gain insight or answers by some type of seance. Obviously, that sounds like something that's not too good. So for us, hopefully, for us, we're going, no, I don't think I want to do that. Soothsaying has to do with fortune telling or foretelling the future, so telling of the future. And it does include astrology, which is something that the children of God shouldn't do. You know, astrology, or, you know, what are you? Are you a whatever they are? There's all those. What sign are you? One commentary said, I'm a stop sign. Leave me alone. But really, the children of God shouldn't have anything to do with that. And really, when I thought about it, this is what I have to say about astrology. Why look to the stars to try to tell me my future when I talk to the one who formed them every day? Amen. And that's the truth, the reality of those who have God in their lives. And it kind of goes right along with the next section, verse 27, not doing what pagans do. You shall not shave around the sides of your head, nor shall you disfigure the edges of your beard. Personally, I like that one. Verse 28, you shall not make any cuttings in your flesh for the dead, nor tattoo any marks on you. I am the Lord. Verse 27, of course, like I said, I don't have any problems with the disfiguring of the beard. But the high haircut thing, I don't like the hair on the edges. But just seriously though, if you've ever looked at those Orthodox Jewish guys with the black suits and the hats, and they usually have a big fluffy beard, and they have what? These curls coming out, right? They're not shaving the sides of their head. They're following this law. That's where this comes from. So those funny looking men, they're just trying to keep God's word. That's no problem. I'm okay with that. So, and then quite obviously, when you look at the context of the cutting of your flesh, it says right there, this stuff, what he's talking about, it's pagan things that pagans were doing. They were doing this stuff in order to mourn for their dead. And they were doing something that God says, this is not what we do as Christians. So quite obviously, this is the verse that says, no tattoos. Right? So when people ask me why I don't have any tattoos, my answer is always this: because I want to go to heaven. And of course I say that tongue in cheek. I'm just kidding around, because this is more of a cultural thing that we don't relate to. I mean, there's usually not a lot of people cutting themselves for the dead or shaving the sides of their heads for the dead or those things going on. So it's one of those things that is a cultural thing. In the context of mourning, in a pagan way, or in a dark or ungodly way, that's really what he's talking about. But it does bring, I mean, there is, if you look this verse up on the internet, there's all kinds of people, like I saw one today, It was a lady that had like a big old Bible verse on her back, and you know, it had the mark and everything, and then right over the top of it, it said Leviticus 19. You know, somebody took that picture and put this label over it, like sinners. You know, and I thought it was funny. I mean, she obviously has something that's of the light tattooed on her body, which is making a statement that it's important. So it does kind of bring up those weird questions, like are there tattoos that really glorify God? And I would say yes. So if you ask me, am I against tattoos? I would say yes, I'm against tattoos. And no, I'm just kidding, I'm not against tattoos, but really I am a little bit against tattoos, but not really. Verse 29. It's a really touchy thing. If you're a kid in here, if you're under 18, I'm against tattoos. You talk to your parents.
Me too.
And you know, seriously though, tattoos are permanent unless you have a whole lot of money and you want to burn them off and it hurts really bad. But you should really pray about it. You should really, anything you do like that. Your body is the temple of the Lord. My wife always brings up a point. She says, and guess what? In Corinthians it says when you get married, your body's not your own, it's your spouse's. So do they care if you have tattoos? Do they want those things on your body? It's kind of a big touchy thing. I'd say pray about it and don't do it. Okay, next, moving on. Verse 39. Whew, man, I'm getting in trouble. Verse 29, pretty easy one here. Do not prostitute your daughter to cause her to be a harlot, lest the land fall into harlotry and become full of wickedness. You shall keep my Sabbaths and reverence my sanctuary. I am the Lord. Verse 31 says, give no regard to mediums and familiar spirits. Do not seek after them to be defiled by them. I am the Lord your God. So again, the verse 29 and 30 are very simple to see. God, and you know, somebody kind of mentioned to me one time that they thought that the Bible didn't look poorly upon having intimacy with the prostitute. There's a few sections of scripture that I recall in my mind that make it look very, very bad and in a really bad light and made poor, what's his name? I said it just a few weeks ago. Judah looked pretty foolish in his sin. So that's one of the ones I'm thinking of. And this verse right here is pretty obvious. God says, don't prostitute your daughter. So hopefully, in that same kind of context, you're thinking, maybe I shouldn't go to a prostitute if God doesn't want me to do this with my daughter. Yes, hello. No brainer. This is a sexual immorality. This is not a thing that is to be tolerated. Of course, Paul, we looked at that, I think, last week. Paul totally said, no, your body is to glorify God, not to fulfill its lusts. So, and then the verse 31 about mediums and spirits, he says, do not seek after them to be defiled by them. I am the Lord your God. So, it's another kind of no-brainer to us. There should be no reason for us to try to contact our great Aunt Helga from the dead. And I mean, that's kind of what he's talking about here by these defilement, these necromancers or soothsayers or whatever. You don't do that. And instead of trying to do something foolish like that, we're to trust the word of God. That our lost, our past or graduated loved ones, they're with him. He's taken complete care of where they're at. And we can trust that. We can rest in that. We don't have to try to contact them. And we also know that you wouldn't be contacting them anyways. You'd be contacting an angel of darkness who can show up and appear as an angel of light, as we see through the Bible. So it's one of those things where I don't touch that stuff. Be excellent in what is good. Be innocent of evil. So, verse 32, you shall rise before the gray-headed and honor the presence of an old man and fear your God. I am the Lord. Amen. Does anyone in here over 40, they can say amen to that. And it's true, it should be done. This is the only verse in the Bible against men dyeing their hair. And really, where I get that is otherwise in traffic, if somebody pulls out slowly in front of you and makes you slam on your brakes and they have black hair, you're going to be mad. But if they're not dyed and they have that white head, you go, okay, all right, I understand. You're 108 years old. I know in the state of Arizona, they're not going to check my license for 40 years, but I hope they're checking yours. No, but anyways, it's really not about that. It really is about respecting our elders. And you know what? There's a loss for that in our nation as well. There really is. There's a loss for just straight up saying, hey, even if they're an ungodly person, saying, you know, you've been here longer than me, I'm going to give you that respect. So I wish we had more of that. And the only way we can do it is change it in our houses and our lives. Amen. So verse 33, and if a stranger dwells with you in your land, you shall not mistreat him. The stranger who dwells among you, you shall be the stranger who dwells among you shall be to you as one born among you, and you shall love him as yourself, for you were strangers in the land of Egypt. I am the Lord your God. So God cares for strangers, or really what he's saying is those who would be in a place in life where they're completely out of place. Have you ever been in a different country and you're like, parlez-vous anglais or whatever? And they're like, and then they come up and they're like, I don't know what you're talking about, but I definitely like to sell you something right now. You know, and you're like, no, I don't want to buy anything. They're like, come on, please, I'll trade you. What do you got? And you're just like, oh, how do you get to the bus station? Anyways, it's one of those things where God's saying, hey man, don't do that to other people. You know how that feels. If they come to you, be genuine, be real, help them. And if they're going to live among you, and in this context, these are somebody that's going to come into your nation, and they're going to, I shouldn't say your nation. It's a little different with the children of Israel. Because when a foreigner came into the nation of Israel, it was because they were going to worship the God of Israel. It was because they were going to live in a different way. And they wanted to leave their nation, and they wanted to follow the one true and living God. Now, people are trying to get into our nation, it's not so they can follow our God, that's for sure. I wish it was. I wish it was. And hopefully, through us doing what the Word of God says and being different, hopefully it can be a place where we reach out in truth. And they see that difference. They see that light. One of the commentaries said, there should be a light shining out that door into this world just because we're in here with God who is light and we're being filled up by Him. And as we go out, may we be that. 35. And you shall do no injustice in judgment, in measurement of length, width, or volume. You shall have honest scales, honest weights, an honest ephah, an honest hin. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land. So that's in all of your dealings. Don't rip anybody off. Be honest, be fair in what you do. Verse 37. Therefore, you shall observe my statutes and all my judgments and perform them. I am the Lord. All right, so I'm not getting in to chapter 20, even though I really wanted to get in there. We're not going to do it. So let's all stand this evening, and we're just going to pray our way out of here tonight. God, we thank you tonight for your word. We thank you for who you are. We thank you for, I just thank you for the fact that you didn't leave us alone. And it just makes sense that God would give his people something to live by. Say, I'm the one that created this life. If you follow these statutes and these principles, it's going to be a blessing to you. God, thank you for that. Lord, we ask that as we go out, we would be practicing real Christians. That would be real about our mistakes and our failures. That would be not hypocrites, God, but just people that love you. And people that are glad that we're forgiven. And people that know what our title is. It's not holier than you. It's, hi, I'm a sinner, saved by grace. So God, thank you for that truth and help us to just live the light. Help us to look different and be different so people can say, what is the matter with you? And you can say, man, I found Jesus and it's the best thing I've ever had. Would you like some? Because I know where he's at. So Lord, bless these people as they go out into the world and as we live Christians, Lord, empower us by your Spirit, and it's in your name we pray, and all God's children said, amen. 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 God bless you guys. Good evening.